Thank you for having me. And I hope everybody had a fabulous lunch. I have been quietly walking around throughout the tables with a pad and a pencil and making a list of the people that have not eaten their vegetables. After I'm done with my presentation, I'm going to put that list on the side door. If you find your name on that list, please meet me in the back room after this presentation. Really. But on a serious note, I am so honored to be here. Like everybody in the room, I also have a personal connection with Alzheimer's disease. One of the true loves of my life, my grandmother, suffered terribly, and I have some of my most fondest memories with her, and then some of my most dismal memories with her as well. And she was this incredibly friendly, bubbly, outgoing pillar of the community. She had loads of friends. She played bridge and mahjong. She was sort of in charge of all of the gossip. I think she created half of the gossip in her community. She was also an art collector. She hit every Broadway show. She traveled extensively. For about 30 years, she was the principal of one of the large public schools in Manhattan. She was a true leader. And unfortunately, one of my most dismal, vivid memories that I have of my grandmother is that when I had my first child, she was already in a nursing home, and she had unfortunately declined slow but steadily. And at this point, she was about 70 years old. And I'll never forget, I packed my daughter, who was only a few weeks old, in the car. It only took me 2 hours to get her from my Manhattan apartment, half a block down, into the parking garage, into the car seat, until we were finally on our way. And I prayed the entire way to the nursing home that my grandmother would at least have a moment that she would come out and acknowledge that she knew that this was her grandchild. And unfortunately, it never happened. But God bless my mother, because she would continuously remind me that although we were suffering, my grandmother wasn't suffering anymore at that point. But today is so different, and I feel so lucky to be a communicator for all of this knowledge that we now have. And I think it's really apropos, before I jump into a presentation, to say a huge thank you to all of the brilliant scientists who are behind the scenes and conducting this research. In addition to the scientists, the charitable donors who provide financial support so that the scientists can do this profound research that then allows communicators like myself to give to all of you this great information that keeps compounding. And I feel very optimistic that in 10 years from now, we're going to have that much more that can really increase the quality of people's lives that are either at high risk or who are already suffering with dementia or Alzheimer's. So I thought today there were so many things that I wanted to be able to cover. But first, what I'm going to do is go over the lifestyle habits that protect against cognitive decline, then food choices that may help to preserve all sorts of mental function, and then lastly, practical brain-boosting foods and snacks, meals and snacks that you could eat on a regular basis that incorporate all of the research that I'll talk about in the beginning of this presentation. So the right ingredients, when we talk about lifestyle changes, can increase focus, attention, memory, cognitive function, and mood. And you can't really talk about improving brain health without talking about a healthy heart. Because if you think about it, neurons, your brain cells function optimally when they are constantly nourished. And how are they nourished? They're nourished through your blood vessels, oxygen and nutrients. So if you have smooth sailing through your blood vessels, again, that's all about heart health, you're going to have a much better shot at optimal brain health. So the first thing we want to do is we want to make sure that our blood pressure is 120, that's your systolic, or less, over 80 or less. And if you have a high blood pressure, most people know that the easiest way to lower that blood pressure, of course, minus medication, is going to be to lose weight if you're overweight and to watch your salt intake. The second thing is know your numbers. When it comes to cholesterol, LDL is the bad cholesterol. Remember, L for lousy and L for low. You want it under 100. We used to say under 130, not good enough. We want it under 100 now. Then you have your HDL cholesterol. Remember, H for hero, H for high. This is the cholesterol that's circulating away from the heart, so the higher the better. And you'll see for men, you want it over 40. For women, you want it over 50. And so again, L for lousy, low. H for hero, high. Now, of course, you want to manage your weight. And I love this little slide. Don't step on it, it makes you cry. But we do know that if you are overweight or you're obese, you're clearly at a higher risk for all sorts of cognitive decline. But where you carry your weight is much more important. So it's really the gut that matters more than, you know, carrying a lot in your hips or your thighs. So this guy, by the way, who claims he's in his thin pants, is going down. So if you want to figure out where you stand in terms of your waist circumference, you're going to grab a measuring tape and you're going to, while standing, use the tape right above your navel. And for women, you want it less than 35. For men, you want it less than 40 inches. And what I do want to say to this point is that a lot of people are just predisposed to carrying a lot of weight in their middle. If you are well above these numbers, even if you just shed an inch or 2 inches, your risk goes down. So it doesn't have to be perfect, it just has to be better. If I told you that I had a pill that could improve every single marker that could put you at risk for either Alzheimer's or a decline in your memory or cognitive function, and all you had to do was pop it every single day, it improved every single marker across the board, and it enlarged the part of your brain that's involved in memory, would you take it? And there was evidence-based research to back up my pill. I would take it. I would take it every single day. It's exercise. Do you know that exercise has been shown to reduce the risk by 30 to 50%? And all you have to do is walk. And what I tell people to do is to walk 30 minutes a day. It doesn't need to require a sweat. You don't need to take a shower afterwards, unless you sweat. And you could also break it up. So, you know, if I'm pitching to you 30 minutes a day, you can break it up into 10 minutes, 10 minutes, and 10 minutes over the course of a day. It's relatively easy. Another thing to think about with exercise is that, you know, I know that before I started to think about this, I was guilty of using my spouse and my 3 kids as my errand boy. You know, get the clicker, see who's at the door, someone find the phone, it's ringing. If you can make the effort to get off the couch and get it yourself each time you're about to ask somebody else to get it, you can't imagine the amount of incidental exercise that you add to the pot. Another thing that you could do, I don't know about you guys, but sometimes I feel like I could get into the Guinness Book of World Records for how many grocery bags I can get from the car into my house. Instead, now what I try to do is one at a time. So it takes me maybe, you know, 8 extra minutes, but I'm going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth from the car and the driveway into my home, and it's really easy. And again, incidental exercise. So all these things add up. Exercise improves blood flow to the brain, elasticity of blood vessels, cholesterol levels, it lowers the LDL lousy cholesterol, it increases the HDL hero cholesterol, it controls your blood sugars, and it produces new brain cell connections, plus it enlarges the part of the brain that involves memory. Exercise is the most powerful thing that I'm going to show you today. So if there's only one thing you remember, remember this.